If he didn't, we'd have to hurt him. Think I'd hurt him?
Amen.
Thank you. Appreciate that. All right. Bring fear to the church. That's what I do. You know, I wanted to show the video clip. We'll do that in a minute after praise and worship. Find the video clip of your dad dancing last night. Will you do that? Just have it ready. We'll show that after praise and worship. It was actually kind of funny. So, yep. Let's go to the Lord. It seems like we're in a good mood. I see a lot of smiles on folks' faces tonight. So let's really get in and do some worship tonight. Can we do that? Amen. Remain Amen. Standing, please.
Amen. Now, last night, if you weren't here, you missed a 52-year-old man dancing. Okay? Now, we're here tonight to worship God. And we can worship God in many ways, right? We can worship Him with our voices. We can worship Him with our instruments. We can worship Him with our whole being. So let's worship the Lord tonight. We're going to kick it off with Oh Happy Day. Where's my drummer at tonight? He ran away? Here we go. Oh Happy Day.
When he was,
when Jesus was.
like Jehovah. There's no God 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 like Jehovah. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun, and the trumpet calls with your voice. It's a year of Jubilee. Out of Zion's new salvation comes. Come on, now we gotta do that again. There's no God like Jehovah. 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 There's no God like Jehovah.
My mind, he saved me. It was just.
this life is o'er, I'll fly away.
Oh,
praise offering. Just tell him how much we love him tonight. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. You may be seated.
I love our church. We can have five people in the beginning and then 100 2 minutes later. I want to do something here, if we could. You guys ready to back me up?
Why not?
All right.
Are you singing?
Yeah, sure. Here comes my solo. Did you hear me? That works. I'm done. That was my solo. Here's what came to mind. It was good praise, good feeling in the place tonight, I think. And Psalms 150 and 3 came to mind. Does anybody know what it says? Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet, praise him with the harp and lyre. There's more that goes to that. Do something, Jim. Praise him on your bass for a minute. I don't know what he's doing, but it works. Robert, do it. Do
something,
on your drums.
You said something about trumpets, right?
There you go. Do something on your drums. There we go.
Hold on.
Get that rhythm.
What can you do, Nancy? Seated if you want to. We had our senior dinner last night, and we had about 25 people show up for the senior dinner, and it was a really good time. And I want to tell you something I've learned about the seniors. They're nuts.
They are.
I was telling Julie today, I said, you know how your impression of someone is totally different than what they really are? You know what I'm saying? You think old, sweet people, nice, never done anything wrong in their life, ever. Do you know what I mean? Never, ever done anything wrong in their life whatsoever. She didn't go along with that. Sister Katie is perfect. Never, ever made a mistake. See, that's what I thought. That's different now. Praise the Lord. And I think the more I hang out with them, the more I think differently of them. They're just like us. Hey, young people, they're just like you. Amen. They cut up and cause problems just as much as you guys do. Now, after this, we got the little video for you. So let's have some fun.
Respect in every aspect and special curse of the man, and God bless anything tested. No, so Jesus Christ said, every time. No, all the muscle man on the crew, no, Mr. Dion, them know for Jesus Christ. Lift them high. I'm not here for Christ. Bust the place, bust the place. No, 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 mercy, yeah.
This song right here is dedicated to all my people that felt like giving up and you didn't think you were gonna make it.
Bless
it
all the time.
Check it out, y'all.
I know you know. Out of
the place. Get up.
Yeah.
Get up. Get up.
She's young.
What can I say?
I'll never be a crush.
Paul's going on comedy tour soon, just so y'all know. Don't worry, we'll get the camera rolling. We'll catch some of you guys soon, too.
Yeah.
Amen. Keith, you got somebody? Kathy, come on down. There we go.
I guess great minds think alike, because I have Psalms 150 in mind tonight. It says, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him with acts of power. Praise him for his suppressing greatness, passing greatness. Praise him with the sound of trumpets. Praise him with the harp and lyre. Praise him with tambourine and dancing. Praise him with strings and flute. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with the resounding cymbal. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So with that, it's time to take up our tithes and offerings. Nancy, will you say the blessing over the offering, please?
Oh, the
grace, how can it be?
Remember, tomorrow night here, we're having a benefit concert, raise money for a church building fund. And if you like bluegrass gospel, we're going to have some pretty good stuff here tomorrow night. So come out. I've had a lot of inquiries about it tomorrow. I think Wayne's had a few inquiries also. So come out for that. You know, it's going to be have a good time tomorrow night. Children's Church, quietly, walk on out. Quietly. Lori, come on up and sing for us, please.
I have thoroughly enjoyed today's weather. Didn't you? It's been beautiful. God is good all the time. I'm going to tell you, He is good. Even on my worst day, He's still good. Because this is temporary. You know, we forget that sometimes. We do. We just think we're going to be in the same situation and nothing's going to change. But you know what? We just keep holding on to God. Things change. And, you know, all I know is He is in control. I can't do nothing about the situation except wait on Him. So I might as well just wait, because I know whatever He's going to do, it's going to be done right. Because if I put my own spin on it and I get my own hand in it, it turns out wrong. And then I have to learn the hard way. I just had to wait on God. You know, so I've learned that lesson. I just wait on God. If I got a problem, I go to God. God is good all the time. So you know what? Listen to me, devil. Tell you what I'm gonna do. You walked on me about long enough. Now I'm gonna walk on you. I said I'm tired of you, Satan. You kept me bound too long, much too long. I'm gonna raise my hand toward heaven. I'm gonna sing me a happy song, a happy song. You told me not to do it. You told me not to try. But I'm gonna keep on serving Jesus till the day I die. I'm tired of you, Satan. You kept me bound too long, much too long. I'm gonna raise my hand toward heaven. I'm gonna sing me a happy song, happy song. God's people got a right to shout. God's people got a right to sing. God's people got a right to praise the Lord. We got everything. I'm tired of you, Satan. You kept me bound. Of Revelations, I see where you are through. I'm tired of you, Satan.
announcement to make here real quick. Tonight's your special night. After church, each family's going to receive a bag of hamburger patties, a bag of McRib patties, a bag of buns, a bag of crumbled burger that you can make chili or put in spaghetti. This is the contents of the blessing bag for every family. Matthew 25:40, I tell you the truth, whatever you did for the least of these, you've done unto me. Amen. So tonight after church, you're going to go home with some food. Praise the Lord. Keith, come on up, sir. Sure. Amen. As you all are probably aware, Wayne's been using the Thursday night service for the past couple of months to give every one of the other ministers an opportunity to preach. It's been a good opportunity for them not only to get to practice, but it's also been a good opportunity for everybody to see just how blessed the Mission Church of God is when it comes to ministers. The only problem with that is he ran out of all those folks, so tonight he had to ask me to preach. So, with that in mind, I'm going to go ahead and try to get started here. One of the things, I haven't preached out here for a long time, as everybody probably knows. I always open my sermons the same way. I open with a small prayer that I believe that the Lord gave me. I know that, you know, it's not the normal way to do things, but that doesn't apply to me. I don't do the normal things. So, I do this in honor of the person who gave it to me. So, if you would you please bow your heads and we can open in prayer. Heavenly Father, fill my mind with your thoughts. Fill my heart with your love. Flood my soul with your grace. And now, if you will, fill my mouth with your words. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. I had something in mind that I was going to start off with tonight. I was all prepared to use. Wayne, I don't know if you ever had that happen to you, but you just know that that's what you're going to do. And then God kind of said, no, I don't think so. So we're going to start off some other way and go with that because I'm trying to be obedient here. Julie, what would you say if I told you that I was going to give you a gift? You would be. You'd be excited about that, right? Okay. And then probably I'm thinking the next thing you would probably think is, okay, what in the world is he going to give me? I would imagine the anticipation would probably kick in a little bit on that. You think, what? Come on, what's he going to give me? I want to know. Okay? And then afterwards, probably, I would assume that you would probably be thankful for the fact that I thought enough of you to give you a gift in the first place. Right? Okay, that makes sense.
wait a minute, Julie. what if I raised the stakes on that a little bit? What if I told you that I was going to give you the greatest gift that had ever been given? Now, how excited would you be? I think so. I think you'd probably really be bubbling over with that. And I also would assume that you'd even be more wondering, just what could this be? I mean, he says it's the greatest gift ever. You know, you have to be anticipating that. You have to be thinking, golly, that's got to be something special. What could it be? And again, probably even more appreciative because the magnitude of the gift. You've been given the greatest gift ever, right? Okay. Wait a minute. Julie, what if, after I told you all that stuff, what if I now brought you a box and gave it to you and said, here's the gift I promised? You went ahead, you tore all the wrapping paper off, all the fancy ribbons and the bows, you opened up the box, and it was empty, except you noticed there was a piece of paper laying in the bottom of the box. You picked up the piece of paper and you unfolded it, and you began to read. All it was a letter from me to you telling you how special I think you are and how much I care for you. Basically sharing my feelings with you. How would you feel then? Well, I think most people probably would be pretty let down, though, because it would be like, you know, golly, you built this up to be such a huge, big deal. This was going to be so great. The greatest gift ever given. And it didn't kind of live up to it. Didn't quite have as much bang for the buck as I was expecting there. Really wasn't what I was expecting at all. I expected a lot more than that, actually. So you'd be disappointed because the presentation didn't live up to your expectation. That's the tonight's sermon title. The presentation versus the expectation. Subtitle is Jesus. The Savior that nobody really wanted. The Bible tells us a similar story of such a gift in Isaiah 7:14, where it says, therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel, meaning God with us. It further states in Isaiah 9:6, for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. That's the gift, folks. The gift was given unto us. The gift was the Son, and it was given, of course, by God. These two scriptures proclaim a gift to be given to all of mankind. The gift's from God to us. And it was beyond any doubt the greatest gift ever given. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but should have everlasting life. Those two scriptures are only two of 44 Old Testament prophecies concerning the coming Messiah. God was announcing his intentions to give mankind the greatest gift ever given. Just as I was talking to Julie about earlier, a gift announcing his feelings, his love for us. See, the excitement and the anticipation for that gift, it should have been overwhelming. The appreciation for his gift, it should have been beyond expression. But was it? That's what we're going to examine for a few minutes here. You know the Christmas story from the second chapter of Luke, right? Remember, no room at the inn? Well, not even born yet, already rejected for lodging. Not a great start. Born in a stable amidst the animals, laid in a feeding trough for the animals. Not much of a beginning for the Son of God, was it? It got better, though, right? Well, in the second chapter of Matthew, we find that there were three wise men that came from the east, and they came seeking he that is born King of the Jews. Now, when King Herod heard about that, he wasn't a very happy camper. See, he figured that he was King of the Jews, and he intended to stay that way. So when he heard about the Savior, His family had to flee to Egypt to escape Herod's decree that all male children under the age of 2 would all be killed. Nobody was going to take his crown away from him. No way. So the family had to stay in Egypt until Herod was dead. Again, that wasn't a very warm welcome that the Savior got, this time from the government of his own nation, too. Still a toddler and already an attempt made to have him killed. Just in a misguided effort to hold onto a crown, keep it from this newborn king of the Jews. Well, okay, but the Savior surely was going to get a better reception from the church and the people, right? Well, let's see. The three main organized groups of the Jewish society at that time were the Herodians, the Pharisees, and the Sadducees. Herodians were a political group. Pharisees were a religious group. Sadducees were sort of a combination. They were a political group, but they were tied to the church. Herodians supported King Herod, so there wasn't much chance Jesus was going to get any reception from them. No friends were going to be found there. The Sadducees, well, you remember when he turned over the money changer table in the temple? Yeah, that was the Sadducees. They weren't real happy about that. So they didn't really exactly warm up to him either. Oh, and they didn't believe in resurrection either. So when he raised Lazarus from the dead, that didn't exactly endear him to them either. They kind of were jealous of the fact that he was very popular with the people. Eventually, they had a midnight illegal trial and handed him over to Pilate. The Pharisees, they also didn't like the fact that he was popular amongst the people. That was the people they were supposed to represent. The funny thing about it, in chapter 11 of John, the Sadducees and Pharisees, both fearing that if they didn't do something, they said, all men will believe on him. Wow, wouldn't that have been a shame? Wow, everybody was going to believe on him. We sure enough better stop that. Can't let that kind of stuff go on. So they took counsel together to have him killed. Two groups that never agreed on anything. They didn't have anything in common. Anything that you would bring up, they would argue about. They never bonded. One thing they finally found that they could agree on, how much they hated Jesus. That was the one thing that brought them together. They wanted him dead bad enough to bury the hatchet. So was he going to be accepted by the religious people and the political folks? Not a chance. Okay. Well, what about the people themselves? They were surely behind him, weren't they? Right? Well, you judge it for yourselves. See, when he began ministering, of course he was unknown. But then word began to spread about him. His teachings, his preachings, the miracles he performed, started the word getting around. So then he started preaching in front of crowds. Crowds became multitudes. Multitudes became growing multitudes, all until the sermon that he had at Capernaum. Now, when he preached at Capernaum, the message was a little bit different. He went into depth. This wasn't all milk. It was meat this time. They weren't really ready for what they were hearing. So since they were hearing about that, they began to murmur and question. Even the disciples, it says, grumbled. John 7 and 66 records that from that time, many of his disciples went away and walked no more with him. Why? Pretty simple. He didn't say what they wanted to hear. That's always the crux of the issues that we have with God. We kind of like God as long as he doesn't really expect anything out of us. When it comes time for us to live up to some expectations that he might have of us, I don't know about that. Don't know if I really want to go that far. That's usually what happens. See, that affected Jesus enough that he asked in the next verse, then said Jesus unto the 12, will ye go away also? Peter said, Lord, to whom would we go? You have the words of eternal life. See, the implication was that we're not going anywhere. We're sticking with you through thick and thin. You couldn't shake us no matter what you did. Well, that's not exactly the way it turned out. See, when Jesus was betrayed in the garden in Mark 14 and 50, it says, and they all forsook him and fled. Not some, not most, all. Mark 14, 51 and 2 records that actually Mark was so anxious to get away that he fled naked. Peter denied him 3 times that he even knew him. Still, I guess there was hope, though, right? I mean, it was Passover time. The Jewish people had a custom at Passover. There was always going to be one prisoner released. And on top of that, it was going to be someone selected by the people themselves. It wasn't somebody foisted on them by the government. They got to make the choice. So obviously the released prisoner was going to be the Savior, right? I mean, they'd make this travesty of justice right, wouldn't they? Well, Matthew 27 records the results on that. Pilate asked him whether he should release Barabbas, a known murderer, or Jesus. They asked for Barabbas. Pilate asked, what should he do with Jesus then? They said, crucify him. He said, but why? He hasn't done anything wrong. They repeated, crucify him. Pilate did everything he could, actually, to set him free. But they all cried for his death. He tried to give life to him. The Jews wanted him dead. His people. When Pilate washed his hands of the innocent man's blood and said that he didn't want anything to do with that, the people said, well, his blood be on us and our children. And it surely has been. Israel's never known a peaceful moment since and probably never will. So could any rejection have been any more complete than that? I mean, could Jesus have been any more universally rejected by every level of Jewish society, from the throne room all the way to the poor fishermen that were his disciples? I didn't even mention the fact that one of the disciples, Judas, actually sold him for 30 pieces of silver. You want to talk about being forsaken? That's the Savior that nobody wanted. See, the problem that Jesus ran into was the same thing that I was talking about earlier. It was one of presentation versus expectation. Remember the title of the sermon, The Story with Julie? Now, what do I mean by that? Let me ask you something. Think about it just for a second. Why'd you all come here tonight? I'm sure there's a reason. Why'd you come? See, if you came for the right reason, you came here expecting, as Paul always says. The question is, what did you come expecting? You should have come expecting to worship God. You should have come expecting to praise Him. You should have come expecting wanting to spend time with God and His people. You should have come expecting to hear the Word of God preached. Now, I believe that most of us did come here to worship and praise God. I also believe that we came here to be with God and His people. I believe that you also came to hear the Word of God preached. But I believe you probably came here expecting to hear it preached by Wayne. So some of you, as a result, are probably a little disappointed with the presentation. See, you are hearing God's word preached, but you're not hearing it by the person that you would have picked. So you might be disappointed. You might be displeased. The presentation didn't live up to your expectation. That was the exact situation that Jesus ran into. The Jewish people knew that he was coming. They knew he'd been promised. They had been promised a Savior. Remember the 44 Old Testament prophecies we talked about? They knew he was coming. The problem was all their preconceived expectations. Just as you thought you knew what to expect from Wayne here tonight, Israel thought they knew what to expect when they got a Savior. When he wasn't what they expected, just as tonight, I'm not what you expected. They didn't warm up to the messenger because they didn't like the message. You see, King Herod and later the Herodians, they only knew that Jesus was being called the King of the Jews, and that made him a threat to them, period. That's all they looked at. So to them, he was just an obstacle that they wanted out of the way. They wanted him killed, period. They didn't want a Savior. Others expected the Savior to be a man of politics, a leader that was going to restore the glory of Israel. Jesus didn't come to involve himself in politics. So he wasn't the Savior they were looking for either. Still others expected the Savior to be a warrior king, someone that was going to throw the rope off the yoke of Roman rule and establish Israel as a cultural center. That's what they thought they were going to get. But Jesus, see, he wasn't a warrior. And he wasn't going to lead them into battle. It's not what he came for. So they too didn't have much interest in this Savior. To any and all of these people, Jesus was one thing, a colossal disappointment. Pharisees, they had a good thing going. They had a position of prominence, and their interpretation of the law was unquestioned and respected. Problem was, over the years, that they had allowed oral traditions to intermingle with the law. And on top of that, they treated these man-made doctrines to have equal strength and validity to the scriptures themselves. It's not what was intended. See, they were very into following the letter of the law and ignoring the spirit. More than anything else, they were intent on one thing: maintaining the status quo. Jesus wasn't interested in the status quo. In fact, he was sent here to turn their status quo inside out, upside down, and every which way but loose. Matthew 10 and 34 says, "Think not that I'm come to send peace on earth. I came not to send peace, but a sword." See, Jesus knew what they were. He knew who they were. And he addressed them again in Matthew 15, 7 through 9. "Ye hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, This people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth, and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. But in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men." He exposed them for who they were. Not going to make him very popular. The inherent weakness of the law had always been that while it did identify sin and it allowed for, you know, as far as sacrifice, it gave them a chance for atonement, it didn't do anything to change the sinner. Nothing at all. It left him exactly the same as he was. It didn't require any change. It brought forth no new creation. All old things did not pass away, and all things did not become new. Jesus said in Matthew 5, 17, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill." Jesus fulfilled the law, but he also came to lift mankind from an outward appearance of righteousness only to an inward change of spirit. That's what God had intended. Remember, God wants us to worship him in spirit and truth. Now, none of this is going to sit very well with the world at the time. Wouldn't sit good with the world today either. It's the truth. You know, who was this man? I mean, who was he to teach them? After all, they were the teachers. To claim he was the Son of God? To call them hypocrites? If this man's the Savior, we don't want him. We only want a Savior if he's what we expected him to be. We want a Savior who'll do what we want, one who meets our expectations. That was their attitude. And it wasn't that they didn't want a Savior, really. It was just that they didn't want this Savior. You know what's really sad about that? It's been 2,000 years. Nothing's changed. Not a thing. Oh, we've gotten a lot of progress, as we call it. You know, we're modern. We're very sophisticated and knowledgeable. But we haven't changed a bit. See, Jesus didn't meet their expectations, so they ignored him, rejected him, and killed him. Israel's still waiting for their Savior today, having rejected him when he came. And today we respond pretty much the same way Israel did. Most people still reject Jesus. Jesus was rejected by the government, the people, and the church. Anybody want to argue that our government still rejects him today? The people, well, 83% of Americans claim to be Christians, according to the latest ABC News poll. Operative word there is claim. That is so far from reality, it's laughable. I doubt if the real number is even 33%. People, not exactly a ringing endorsement from the people. As for the church, help me, Lord, I'm going to need it. Many of us reject him also. How? Well, even among the church, the professing Christians, if you will, come on, I mean, we're so resistant to any real change, it's unbelievable. We treat sanctification like it's a cuss word. Romans 12 and 2 says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I don't think this should be news to anybody, but transformed means changed. In this case, changed into that new creation that we're supposed to become. In Kentucky talk, all that means is that we're supposed to be thinking differently. Changed. See, if you still think like the world does, if you still think the way you did before you met Jesus, I'm going to tell you something. Something's seriously wrong with you. Seriously wrong. Many Christians have got the attitude that they know exactly what serving God is all about. And that preconceived idea they have, that's the Christian they're going to be. Period. A conversation with them goes a little bit like this. Hey, how's your growth in the Lord coming along? Don't expect any real change in me. I know how to be a Christian, thank you very much. Well, how about tithing? No, I don't tithe. I don't believe in all that. Darn preacher trying to sell salvation is all that is. But it's in the Bible. That doesn't matter. You know how they twist those things. Well, how about church attendance? What about it? I come to church every few weeks, months, whenever I can. But the Bible says neglect not. Look, I can't help it if the church happens to be on the same time as the ball games. You know, it's not my fault. Well, but which is more important? Hey, I can go to church anytime, but I got to watch the game when it's on. What about ministering to others? Hello, that's what we pay the pastor for. If I'm going to have to minister to people, we need to get rid of him and start paying me. Something doesn't compute there. It must be me. So we're unwilling to change. And we're going to do just exactly what we like, whether God likes it or not. Wow, sounds like the Pharisees are alive and well today. Also, just talking about ministering for a second. You know, why is it that people that are totally reluctant to do any ministering themselves, why are they always the major ones to critique everybody that does try to minister? Now, I know that's off the subject, and I threw that in totally for free. But I'm just asking. Did I actually say that? Yeah. Sometimes there's really greasy words that slip right out on you. Carrie, we were talking about that the other day, and you know, I probably should have caught that, but it's done out, and I can't get it back now. So, anyway, most of us still don't want a Savior. Not really, or at least we don't want Him as He is. I mean, we might take Him on our own terms. Does that sound familiar? Maybe it should, because it's exactly what Israel did. See, what we really want is an omnipotent version of Santa Claus. We don't want to serve Him. We want Him to serve us. Come on. Give me, bless me, love me, heal me, save me. Come on. Me, me, me. When are you going to understand that it's not about you? It's supposed to be about Him. It's not about you. Another crazy words. You know, I'm already in. Let's go all the way. Folks join the church. And they want to do certain jobs, but those jobs are already filled by good folks. So they expect those folks to be removed to accommodate them. Wow. Others join church and they expect the pastor to give them time and space to take over part of the service. Well, because they're going to minister in song, prophecy, whatever, something. Right? That's not realistic, folks. It's not about you. If God called you to minister, he'll give you an opportunity, and he won't give it to you by taking it away from somebody else. That's not of God. When those folks are other people that's already in the church, when they don't get the attention that they want, then they start threatening to leave. That's spiritual blackmail, folks. Call it like it is. Or they do leave. Let me tell you something. That's not God. That's flesh. That's ego. But it's not God. And then when those folks do leave the church, then they leave the church, you always hear them say, God moved me on. Hogwash. If God moves you to another church, it's going to be to enable you to be used in a new area of ministry. New areas of ministry are going to open up before you. You're going to see things happening that you weren't seeing happen before.